Hello, and welcome to the newest episode of the New Year 6 podcast. This episode, I'll be doing my 2023 ACC conference preview, starting at the bottom of the conference, working my way up, and calling out a player to be on notice about, player that may make a significant impact on every team, your sleeper pick for the years, and just looking across the conference, seeing who's going to succeed, who's going to fall short, everything in between. So to kick it off, starting at the bottom of the ACC, these bottom three teams in particular, at least in my eyes, are all kind of interchangeable where they end up. I'll start with the team that I think is going to finish in last, and that would be Georgia Tech. Georgia Tech is not there, with the rest of the conference right now. That skill level is just still, pretty steep from them, with a lot of the heavy hitters in the middle of the middle of the conference, the top of the conference. They're just not on that level yet. Brent Key will have his time, and he'll have his opportunity to develop the program into whatever he wants it to be. Took over mid-year and looked respectable, but there's still too many question marks right now. The schedule for Georgia Tech, as always, is going to be unfavorable. Playing Georgia, and you're out of conference. So with that in mind, it's just going to be too tough for them to overcome. Looking at the offensive side of the ball, they're really only solid player, at least in a skill position, is going to be Dante Smith. I like him at running back. But I think your breakout star from your offense is going to be whoever ends up winning that quarterback battle. It could be Haynes King coming over from Texas A&M, but right now, I'm personally leaning towards Zach Pyron. And, this is a guy who saw some action last year, kind of came in halfway through the season, threw a touchdown in every game that he started. So he started against Florida State, started against Virginia Tech, and started against Miami. So he's seen some quality opponents. He's performed against them, threw 253 yards against Virginia Tech. Had a rushing touchdown against FSU and Virginia Tech. So dual threat guy, someone that can throw it out there. It's really going to be, can the receiving room come to life as well? I like Dominic Blaylock, but ultimately it's going to rely on Pyron to, have that team rise to the occasion on offense. And, we'll see what happens. I don't expect a lot out of Georgia Tech this year. But, if anything is going to happen, it's going to be on the shoulders of Pyron there, quarterback, or King, whoever ends up winning the battle. On defense, again, pretty big question marks across the board. I don't look at any position group and think that they're even close to maybe the middle of the conference. You got a few playmakers here and there, on that D line. Kyle Kennard is a solid D end in your linebacker room, like Andre White. But, ultimately speaking, the secondary is going to be, a main point of weakness. They have Lamiles Brooks back there at safety, but ultimately, I think your breakout player is going to have to come from the secondary if they're going to make a difference. And the guy I'm leaning on is Keenan Johnson at cornerback. So, very limited playing time so far in his journey, especially last year. Has a little bit of stat line, here and there. Passed deflected against Virginia Tech, couple tackles against Duke, couple tackles against Georgia. But, ultimately, it's a fairly young secondary across the board. They only have one senior in Miles Sims. So, this is an opportunity for him and these other, D-backs to get that rhythm going, get that experience, especially going into next year. But I think for where they're at right now, Georgia Tech is in a tough spot. They're rebuilding, and, whether or not the school gives, Brent Key enough time to do a full rebuild, or if they go into the coaching search at the end of this year, time will tell. But don't expect a whole lot of out of Georgia Tech this year. Coming up next in 13th place, again, no divisions in the ACC this year, so we can play around with it a little bit. 13th, I'm going to go for Virginia Tech. Tough first year for Brett Pry. So with that in mind, still a part of that rebuild, still moving things along at his pace. It may be sooner than later. I think Virginia Tech is an easier rebuild than Georgia Tech. But I think for right now, it's going to be tougher than tougher to win at Virginia Tech than it is at these other schools that are ahead of them. On the offensive side of the ball, looking at I do like their receiver room. I do think they got some playmakers there. That Allie Jennings is a receiver that's should be near the top of the conference. Daquan Felton. So they have playmakers on the offensive side of the ball. Grant Wells is, at least in my eyes, kind of middle of the conference. So they do have a foundation. And if they are going to win, it's going to be through throwing in the air. But the player I think is most likely to break out as a result of that is going to be Malachi Thomas at running back. So missed 8 games last year due to injury. And the limited time that he did play, he showed spurts of what he could be. Touchdown against Pitt, receiving touchdown against Miami, so he can add to that receiving threat. But I think for right now, they're going to rely on Thomas in the backfield to step up his game and be a contributor, not just to the passing or receiving game, but also to the to the run game, and establishing it so it takes pressure off of Grant Wells at quarterback. On the defensive side of the ball, I do like their secondary. I do think their secondary is a sleeper in this conference. Nazir Peoples is one of the top safeties in the conference. I like Derek Canteen at nickelback. In the linebacker position, I'm looking more towards the middle of the conference. Guy like Alan Tisdale can play, but that front four is where questions start to come up, at least on my end. I don't see who that big playmaker could be. It may be Narrell Pollard at defensive tackle, but there's not a lot of decisive explosive playmakers. I do think that your player to watch on Virginia Tech's defense is going to come from that D line, and it's going to be Mario Kendricks. So again, very limited playing time. He is a senior. There are a good chunk of seniors on this defense, so it is going to be that time for them to step up and answer the call. Sack against Georgia Tech last year, pass defended against Liberty. So, he has had these little moments. He has had these opportunities where, he's shown he can do it. But now in a more consistent role, will he be able to step up? Will he be answered to hold down the fort at defensive tackle and put pressure on an opposing offensive line the way that Virginia Tech needs? All right, so we had Georgia Tech in 14th, Virginia Tech in 13th. 12th is going to be a shocker, I think, to a lot of people. This is a team that I think a lot of people out there are high on this year. I'm going to wait and see, and I'm going to see if Lightning can strike twice in the ACC. So in 12th, I'm going to pick Duke. And, I know after the year they had last year, that's probably a crazy pick. But, the reality is that, I still think there's a pretty divisive or distinct skill gap between the top of the conference and where Duke is at. Duke maybe get there one day, consistently. I think Mike Elko is the guy. If Texas A&M doesn't pick him up after they fire Jimbo one year. But, I think Mike Elko could build a pretty substantial program. But for right now, I think it's going to be very hard for them to replicate what they did last year. I could be proven wrong, but I see them kind of fighting in this 12th spot and, in the general vicinity of that. On the offensive side of the ball, across the board, I think there's playmakers on both offense and defense. There's no one area that strikes me as dominant. You can argue Jordan Waters at running back is going to be your guy. He could be near the top of the conference. in the receiver room, they do have some playmakers there. They got Jordan Moore, Jalen Calhoun. I like Nicky Dalmullen at a tight end. So with that in mind, I think, you know, the expectation in your breakout player is going to be Riley Leonard. And I know last year he had a pretty big year, kind of coming out of nowhere and establishing himself. What I mean by breakout at this point is going to be he graduates from a solid quarterback in the conference to presumably one of the top ones in the ACC. So with that in mind, I think Riley Leonard in some degree needs no introduction. 391 yards and 4 touchdowns against Wake last year, 3 rushing touchdowns against Miami, 20 on the year, almost 3,000 yards in the air. So, the guy can do it all, and it's not expected from a program like Duke to do that year in and year out. So, just having him be Duke's next Daniel Jones would be huge for this program, especially if they're trying to take a step in Mike Elko's second year and shoot for the top of the conference. On the defensive side, I think the defense is a little worse off than the offense. I think with Duke, the issue is to that, again, I don't see them having a weakness in any one area. I don't see the dominance in any one area. And I think that will be picked apart at some point by the rest of the conference. I like their secondary a little bit more than the other position groups on defense. Looking in that secondary, Jalen Stinson at safety is a nice safety. I like, Brandon Johnson at the nickelback spot. Linebacker group is, linebacker group and D-line are a little worse off, not quite as deep. Cam Dillon at linebacker is solid. You can go, Dwayne Carter on the D-line. And these are all, generally speaking, older guys. There's some younger players on Duke that are going to get some significant playing time. And, I think Duke can use that to their advantage if they are going to win games, on the defensive side of the ball. I think your playmaker on Duke, the guy that comes out as, your player to watch, is going to be, this is going to be a rough version of it, but Jameon Franklin. So, guy who's seen pretty solid playing time so far, especially as a senior. He's able to stick his paw up there. Got a couple of passes defended against Virginia, which tough to do on that D line. Sack against Virginia. Sack against Northwestern. So he can get that pressure. He can get into the backfield. He can hit a QB. He's got that reach and that length to bat passes down, some J.J. Watt action. And, when you think about that long term, it's going to be big for Duke to get that consistently. So if we expect that from Franklin week in and week out, it can free up some of those other guys on the D-line potentially, knowing that, the O-line's got to take all four of them. They got to go back into the linebacker group as well. So if they can get that pressure and they can consistently ensure that, the running game is getting stopped, Duke may, surprise a few folks. And again, maybe just surprising me, Duke is projected to do pretty well by, I think, the majority of other experts out there. But I'm not high on them right now. I can be proven wrong. But if they are going to do well this year, it's going to be because of the play of Leonard at quarterback and Franklin on the defensive line. So look at that, those last three, Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke in 12th. These next three are going to be teams that I think are going to hover around bowl eligibility, right around that 500 mark, maybe win a game or two that they probably shouldn't. And, kind of take it from there. So my 11th place team in the ACC this year is going to be Virginia. So Tony Elliott had a rough year one. A lot of stuff that wasn't it wasn't in his control. They had the tragedy there in Charlottesville. But, heading into year two, I do expect them to take a little bit of a jump. I do expect them to be a little bit more competitive within the conference. I do have some question marks in quite a few positions. I like the addition of Tony Musket coming out of Monmouth and quarterback spot. Otherwise, that offense was going to be in a fairly rough spot. I think there's questions at running back, whether Paris Jones can answer the call and step up in a big way. I don't know who their playmaker is in wide receiver. I imagine it's going to be Malik Washington in the slot. So one of those receivers is going to have to step up and deliver in a big way. If that is going to be the case, and as I predict it will be, it's going to be Demick Starling, who very limited playing time over the course of his career. But the thing that caught my eye was he had a nice 40-yard catch against North Carolina last year. So he can be that big play guy. Again, that's one play out of a handful of catches he's had over the course of his collegiate career. So if he can replicate that week in and week out and give Musket some options. By the way, Tony Musket is an amazing name for a quarterback. He's got a musket for an arm. It writes itself. NIL, get in there and help a guy out. But if Musket's going to have some options at wide receiver, Starling's got to be one of them. Now, on the defensive side of the ball, again, a lot more questions, but I do like this front four a lot. I look at it as one of the best options, or one of the best D-line in the conference, potentially. Cam Butler is the real deal. Aaron Faumui is another great defensive lineman. But if we go further back, the linebacker room is, you can say questionable. I like James Jackson a little bit, but that's not going to be the guy I pick as my breakout. Looking at the secondary, you have got Jonas Sanker in their nickel. I think they, nickel. What else? Antonio Clary in the safety. So they do have guys that can step up. It's a fairly old defense. Just looking at the spreadsheet I've got in front of me, there's only two that aren't going to graduate this year. So not a lot of returning production for 24, but that is a problem for next year's team. The transfer portal exists. We're focusing on 2023. So if I'm looking at who I think is going to break out, it is going to go back to the linebacker room, but I'm going to go with Josh Ahern. So looking at what he's done, and again, not a ton of time, not a ton of time consistently played or consistently on the stat sheet. Picked up a sack last year against Richmond, so FCS opponent. Just showing, doing things that as a Power Five starter you should be doing. Three tackles against Louisville, so getting around, making plays, and as a linebacker, you're making those tackles so their secondary doesn't have to. So being that next line of defense is big. So I think Ahern has a big opportunity this year. Him and Jackson to be, that dynamic duo. They run a 4-2-5 at Virginia. So with that in mind, he's got to be covering the middle of the field. He's got to be, covering slot receivers. He's got to be, in the backfield, applying pressure. They're going to use him in a, as a Swiss Army knife at Virginia this year. So, if he can step up and be that playmaker, after that, those front four can apply that additional pressure. It can mean big things for Virginia. So we'll see how it works out. But be on the lookout for Starling at receiver, Ahern at linebacker. So that was the team I have in 11th place. So recapping: Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia at 11th. In 10th place, we got another team with quite a few question marks surrounding them, and with a little bit of turnover across the board. And I'm going to go with Wake Forest. Wake Forest is always a team that kind of defies expectations. They don't position themselves as this this team that's going to make a run at the conference title, and then they're sitting there middle of October, 5-1, 6-1, and everyone's kind of scratching their head, how did they get there? But I think for Wake Forest, it's more of a come back to reality, middle of the ground year, middle of the road. They finished sixth in their division last year, so 10th in the conference would be, yeah, like 5th, 6th. So, you know, kind of right in that middle spot or near the middle. Looking at the offensive side of the ball, obviously Sam Hartman is out. So, you know, whole new crew on that front. Still love the receiver group, you know, and that's been Claussen's specialty as head coach there. They air it out. I think they just ended the league, A.T. Perry. So, you know, and that's the case here with this offense. You know, they still have Jamal Banks, they still have Taylor Morin, Donovan Green. They still have a lot of playmakers coming back for this year. And theoretically, they can come back next year, too. Yeah, this is a very young offense, which, could make a wave in 24. But, you know, again, sticking to 23, I think their receiving room, at least from a returning production point of view, is the top of the conference. I like Justus Ellison at the running back spot. So if I like those two, that leaves QB by default. That, in this case, it's going to be Mitch Griffiths. As the standout player or the breakout player for Wake Forest. So, he got a little bit of action to start the season off. Sam Hartman had some health issues, didn't know if he was going to play last year, ended up coming in, about 3 weeks into the season. So, three touchdowns in his start against my VMI. And again, VMI is, FCS school, so, nothing to really write home about, but showed that he can play at the level that's needed from him. Had touchdowns against Army, touchdowns against Louisville. So opportunities have come up for him. He's showed up. He's delivered when he's needed to. Can he do that for an entire 12-game stretch? It's to be seen, but there's enough of a sample size for me to believe that, he's due for a good year, and he's due to lead Wake Forest at least to a bowl game, if not more. On the defensive side of the ball, if you're looking at the highlights, the linebacker room is tight. Chase Jones coming back, Jacob Roberts, the two in the middle are going to do a lot this year. I'm good with the front four. I think, generally speaking, that front six in general, those that D-line and linebacker position are going to be strong for Wake Forest. Looking up front, Kevin Pointer is a playmaker. Bryce, I don't know how to pronounce his last name. Ganias. Jasheen Davis up front. So there's a lot of guys, and at least in that D line, not a single one of them is graduating this year. So if they declare early, that's something else. But looking at what they could do, there's some playmakers in the future up front. But I'm gonna lean towards the secondary just because there's some more questions back there. I like Chellen Garnes at the safety position. Is special. His co-safety, Malik Mustafa, he's talented as well. So I'm going to go with actually the youngest guy that I think will play significantly on this defense. The only sophomore that I think is going to start is Deshaun Jones. So again, limited playing time last year, two passes defended against Army, had a nice performance against UNC with six tackles all solo. So has shown that he can get around and can make plays when needed. I don't think it's great that a cornerback is having six tackles in a game, but he is making those plays and he is getting stops. So, with that in mind, I expect a bigger year from him. I expect more passes defended, maybe an interception, but I think for the time being, being the youngest player on the secondary and on this defense, gives him an opportunity and gives him a chance to step up in quite a few different scenarios and situations that he hasn't had in the past. All right. So with that, Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke in 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest in 10th. So in 9th, this is going to be a team that I think makes a fairly sizable leap. And I think for the sake of the head coach's job security, it's a leap that was needed. And I'm going to go in I'm going to go with Boston College. So that's what, 9th, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9. Yes. Ninth place I'll go with Boston College. This is the year that Jeff Halfley takes things back to where they needed to be. 3-9 last year is unacceptable. You know, pretty much any Power 5 school. But you know, looking at you know, the struggles they've had, I think they bounce back a little bit this year, get into that bowl eligibility range. You know, Halfley saves his job for this year, and you know, we look at you know, what happens in the future. But for the time being, you'll see Jeff Halfley in 2024. On that offensive side of the ball, really like Pat Garwo as a running back. Definitely upper half of the conference. The receiving room, I think, is kind of somewhere in the middle. You know, Ryan O'Keefe is a special receiver. Joseph Griffin Jr. So definitely some, you know, definitely some talent on those in those positions. You know, so with that in mind, you know, with the receiving room is you know, buttoned down, the running back room is solid. Then I'm going to go with QB, and I'm going to go with Emmett Moorhead as your breakout player of the year. And you know, looking at what he's done, you know, so far in a smaller sample size, I think he had some health issues last year or didn't play pretty consistently. But you know, 4 touchdowns against Duke, 330 yards against NC State. So the playing time that he has shown us so far, he's delivered, and he's given us little spurts and shown us what he can be. And I think with you know, with a consistent starting role this year, you know, with you know, the receiving weapons that he's got, with a healthier O-line, you know, I think he can do some damage in this conference and end up you know, accelerating towards the, you know, pretty solidly towards the middle, if not higher, as a QB. So looking at the defensive side of the ball, Boston College actually has a pretty good front 7 or front 6. You know, I would put it in, you know, I would put it near the top of the conference if you really look at that returning production. Looking at that D line, you know, you guys, you know, Donovan, I'm going to butcher this name too. Donovan Ezeruaku. You know, you got Cam Horsley in the nose tackle spot. So you got some players up there in the linebacker spot. You got Vinny DePalma, Cam Arnold. So guys who have made a pretty significant impact so far on their in their collegiate journey. The secondary is where I've got some issues. I think the secondary has a lot to prove right now. Not a lot of experience coming back. I think it's going to be one of the more questionable ones in the ACC. They do have, I mean, Victor Nelson's a pretty solid safety, but that's, you know, that's going to be your leader. So with that, I'm going to have to pick someone in the secondary. They're, you know, when you're running a 4-2-5, those secondary spots are important. So I'm going to go with Amari Jackson at that nickelback role. Again, one of a couple of sophomores. So this is a young defense across the board. But, you know, Jackson's one of those sophomores. 2 passes defended against UConn. So, and I know UConn is usually like a cupcake game. UConn was not terrible last year. They were bowl eligible. So, you know, it's not ACC level, but it's nothing to write off. 5 tackle performance against Wake Forest. And again, Wake Forest always kind of, you know, rides the middle there. So, you know, having Jackson, you know, as a strong nickelback, someone who can command the secondary and be that leader for, you know, be that leader for the defense with a, you know, with a strong linebacker group and with a strong D line. You're going to be in a position to do a lot of things right if that's the way it comes out. So, all right. So, to recap, Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th. With that in mind, I think these next 4 or so teams, so this would be 8 through 5, are all interchangeable. I think you could, you know, the team you got in 8th could be finish in 5th. The team you got in 5th can finish in 8th. But I think for the time being, we'll kick it off with the team I've got in 8th. I'm going to go with Miami. So You know, Miami did not have a good year last year. Cristobal struggled in year one. You know, selfishly speaking, loved seeing it. Go Gators. Loved seeing Miami, you know, down and, you know, offseason champs and then struggling during the year. But I think this year they do take a step forward. I mean, they really have to in the ACC. The expectations are higher in Miami than they are in the majority of the conference. So anything less than, you know, bowl eligibility is going to be it's going to be a pretty significant step back. Looking at the offense, fortunately, they do have Tyler Van Dyke. I know he didn't have a great year last year. I'm still riding that, that Van Dyke hype. So, I do think he can return to form and be what Miami needs of him. Everything around him is a little bit more of a question mark for me. You know, Henry Parrish is, you know, a middle of the road running back in the conference. On the receiving, in the receiving core, Colby Young is really like your only star out there, and I use it very loosely compared to some of the other teams in this conference. So I am going to lean on the receiving core to step up, and I think your breakout player as a result of that is going to be Jacoby George. So, you know, very light playing time, 5 catches against Duke. 41 yards against A&M are kind of the highlights there, but I expect more coming out of this year than what we've gotten in the past. He's going to be one of your starting three out there, so expect more of that. Expect more of those opportunities. Expect more of that that chance there for George to shine as a wide receiver, one in his role. So, that's what I'm looking for if I'm Miami. I expect, the passing game to get established again. I expect Van Dyke to return to form. I expect Parrish to, continue to evolve as a runner. But, I think for the time being, George is going to be the guy that steps up at the end of the year and as someone we look back and, are impressed by his play. On the defensive side of the ball, really the only group that impresses me, this is, kind of the Tyler Van Dyke of the defense. The only group that really impresses me is the secondary. I think they're clearly upper half in the conference. I look at guys like James Williams and Cameron Kinchins in the safety, two dynamic players that, have shown us that they're able to step up and deliver. The D line, I think, is solidly in the middle of the conference. And I think fortunately for Miami, this is a very young defense. So this is where a lot of them are going to get that playing time and it's going to come into fruition together. On the D line, Akeem Mesidor, knows how to get into the backfield. Jafari Harvey, another name to look out for, another name that's, put himself in a position to succeed on this team. But I'm looking at the linebacker group as that opportunity for a playmaker to emerge. They already have one with Francisco Mauigoa, but looking at who he'd be playing with, that's where that opportunity to step up comes from, and that'll be Wesley Bisanthe. This is a four-star kid coming out of the class of 22, and as a result of that, I'm sure his offer list was insane. He started or played significant minutes as a true freshman for Miami, so good enough to be on that field. Miami's going to have a young team across the board. I don't remember 22's recruiting class offhand, but 23's recruiting class was, it was easily top 10. I don't remember where they ended up, but 7 tackles against Clemson, the premier opponent in the conference until proven otherwise. So, shown what he's been able to do with a very small sample size, I think that sample size is going to expand rapidly this year, and expect Bisanthe to evolve into his role and show that he's ready to be the next great Miami linebacker. All right, so that was on 14th. Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 9th, Boston College 8th. Did I do this right? 14th, 13th, 12th, 11th, 10th, 9th. Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 9th. Boston College 8th, Miami 7th. Gotcha. So now we are in. Nah, I did this. Damn, really? Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th. Okay. So now we're in 7. Now we're squarely in the middle. And I'm going to go with a team that, you know, really rose to the occasion last year and defied pretty much all expectations that were out there. And I'm going to go with Syracuse. So last year, you know, 500, made a bowl game. You know, that hot seat for Dino Babers was cooking going into last year. They went, I think, 1-10 during the pandemic, won like two or three games in 22 or in 21. So, you know, last year was needed, and, you know, they delivered in a pretty big way. Looking at the offensive side of the ball, you know, having Garrett Schrader back on you know, a QB is going to be huge. A lot of the other position groups on this team, though, especially on offense, is where I have some questions. You know, obviously losing Sean Tucker at running back means that room is potentially one of the least proven. I think, you know, I mean, not potentially, it is the least proven running back room in the conference. But looking at receivers real quick, you know, really your only standout guy is Aronde Gadsden. So everyone else is you know, younger and or unproven. You know, haven't stepped up to that degree yet. But with that in mind, I am going to stick with the running back room, and I'm going to pick. I'm not going to pick LaQuint Allen, who at least has a little bit of experience. So with Syracuse, they're one of the few teams out there that still uses a fullback, and in this case, Elijah Wright, who converted from D line to become a fullback. I'm really interested to see how Syracuse uses him this year. So I'm gonna pick Elijah Wright as the breakout player. I know they can probably use him in a blocking capacity, you know, maybe receiving, maybe goal line, you know, pushes. I'm not sure what capacity they're going to use him in, and that's what makes it so interesting and so captivating to put him as your breakout player of the year on offense. On the defensive side of the ball, I think this is where Syracuse is going to win a lot of games next year. Their secondary is you know, pretty top tier when it comes to returning production. You know, Jason Simmons Jr., Justin Barron. So, you know, I mean, you can go deeper than that. You can go Isaiah Johnson. You can go Elijah Clark. You know, they have a lot of skilled players in the secondary that, you know, can get up there, make plays, you know, bat down balls, pick them off. They can do pretty much everything that you need them to. And knowing that this is a 3-3-5 style offense or style defense, on the defensive side, you know, again, more playmakers across the board. Marlo Wax, you know, your senior leader at linebacker. Stephon Thompson, you know, another guy that can, you know, you know, play up close and play in that kind of, you know, linebacker edge role, however they end up using him for this year. But the D-line is really where I think you have the most questions. You know, you do have a strong player out there in Caleb Ochukwu. We'll see. But, you know, with that in mind, I think you're you know, your breakout player is going to be someone you brought in from Alabama. So they brought in Braylon Ingraham to play on that D-line. 4-star coming out of the class of 2019. Didn't crack the depth chart. This is where, like, you have to be pro-transfer portal, because, you know, if he has to just sit there and he can't use his free transfer and he's just wasting his way, he could have a huge year, build up his draft stock, and, you know, make be an impact player. That's what I think he's going to do in Syracuse. You know, the pressure is lighter. You know, if it doesn't work out for him, it doesn't work out for him. But it wasn't going to work for him sitting on the bench as a junior. So, you know, expect a bigger year from Ingraham. Expect him to make an impact on this D-line for Syracuse, and you know, really show what he can do. All right. So again, I'm going to get it right this time, I swear. Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th, Syracuse 7th. So now we head over to 6th place, and this is a team with a new head coach with something to prove. You know, they did a lot of work last year, but the year their prodigious son is has returned. You know, Jeff Brohm is back at Louisville, and I think he succeeds, you know, pretty highly in his first year here. So, looking at what they've got, I like the addition of Jack Plummer from Cal. I think he immediately steps in and hits the role that, you know, Malik Cunningham left now that he's in the NFL. The running back room and the offense and the wide receiver room have some question marks. Jawar Jordan is, you know, has some bright spots, has some potential, has that chance to step up. In the receiving room, you know, Jamari Thrash, again, another top tier NIL name. Jamari Thrash, ACC All Conference first or last name, but you know, he's the only 1,000-yard guy you've got on this team. So with that in mind, I'm going to pick a true freshman. I'm going to pick someone who's going to step up and hit, like, immediately as they get to campus, and it's going to be Jamari Johnson from, you know, as a tight end. So 4-star true freshman, and, you know, how many of them were coming to Louisville on average, and how many of them can make a splash immediately? Johnson will be one of those kids. Brohm is recruiting very, very well so far. You know, again, year one, 0-0 record, but on paper, he's putting some special teams together for the future. And, you know, you'll see year one what type of impact his kids can make. Jamari Johnson will be that guy. I think he's going to start as a true freshman at tight end. So by virtue of, you know, nothing proven, sky is the limit, he's your guy. On the defensive side, you know, at least in my eyes, and this may be you know, controversial, best secondary in the conference. You know, a lot of returning production: Jarvis Brownlee, MJ Griffin, Josh Minkins. You know, I really do think this is a special secondary and someone that's, you know, going to create a rough time for opposing quarterbacks. The D-line is below average compared to the conference. I like Stephen Heron, but really outside of Ashton Gilote, really outside of them, it's tough to see who those third and fourth playmakers going to be. The linebacker room is the one with the most amount of questions. There's pretty much just no experience coming back there. So I'm going to go with a true freshman. I'm going to go with Stanquan Clark as your breakout player. Again, another 4-star freshman coming to Louisville, another guy that's ready to make an impact immediately. And he's going to show these 24 and 25 kids, if you step up and you work hard, you will see the field immediately. So with Clark at linebacker, Johnson at tight end, 2 4-star kids that are coming in with something to prove, and I think in that first year they're going to do it. All right, so again, recapping: Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th, Syracuse 7th, Louisville 6th, so we are now in our top 5. And again, I think Miami, Syracuse, Louisville could all be teams that compete for this 5th place spot. But with that in mind, this was one of the more impressive teams in the conference last year, and I expect them to continue to make a splash, you know, within the conference. And it's going to be Mac Brown's Tar Heels out of North Carolina. Made it to a conference championship game last year. Couldn't put it together, but you know, generally a quality year for North Carolina last year. Looking at the offense, you have the best quarterback in the conference with Drake May. Someone that could potentially declare after this year and you know, be heading to a day one NFL draft position. Elijah Green can do a lot on the ground. You know, one of your better running backs in the conference, and your receiving room is electric as well. Yeah, I mean, as a result of having the best quarterback in the conference, your receiving room kind of follows. So, you know, guys like Devontae Walker, Nate McCollum. So, you know, generally speaking, you know, some talented players out there. So it's tough to pick one when every position group has their stars. But I'm going to go with the tight end. You know, again, a receiver that hasn't showcased it as much yet. I'm going to go with John Coppenhaver. So, very limited, stat line right now. You know, 47-yard catch against Georgia State shows that he can break one off and make a big play. I know Georgia State is not an ACC quality opponent. They're mid-bottom Sun Belt, but three catches against Pitt, you know, kind of shows that he can get those short gain, short catches up and running as well. So, you know, you combine those two and you combine him with the weapons that also exist on this offense, and you know, you have a recipe for a very successful offense this year. On the defensive side, I know the defense struggled last year. I think the defense is going to make a huge leap this year. I expect each position group on this defense to be top five in the conference. So, you know, last year was rough. Last year, they gave up a ton of points and then, you know, just aerated them out. And, you know, if they were giving up 35, UNC would score 42. Who was it that week one game? App State, where they won like 63-61 or something crazy. So expect less of that. I think this defense comes together a little bit more this year. I like the linebacker room a lot with, you know, Cedric Gray and Power Eccles. And again, another top-tier conference name, Power Eccles. So those two at the linebacker spot are going to, you know, again, they're going to hold down the field. They're going to, you know, be the leaders out there. And you got both of them back, which will be huge for these younger players that are coming out there. I really like this D-line. I like, you know, Kevin Hester Jr., Miles Murphy. A very experienced group up front, all seniors. Both your linebackers are Power Eccles is a junior, but everyone else out there has been there 4 or 5 years and is ready to win the conference. And, you know, that's the goal. It's ACC champs or bust. The secondary is where I think your breakout player is going to come from. You have a lot of playmakers there. You got Giovanni Biggers, DeAndre Boykins, you know, so quite a few guys that can step up. Elijah Huzzy. But I think it's going to be the youngest player out there. I think it's going to be Marcus Allen, not OJ's teammate, but Marcus Allen, you know, sophomore cornerback, really played more towards the end of the year. So, you know, passes defended against Clemson and NC State, six tackles in their bowl game against Oregon. So really came into his own as the year progressed. Again, true sophomore, so played more than four games as a freshman. And an ACC program, especially when competing for a conference championship, that's a big deal. So I expect Marcus Allen to really establish himself more as the cornerback of the future for North Carolina. And as a result of that, you know, North Carolina is going to win a lot of games across, you know, by any means necessary. They don't have to rely exclusively on Drake May and his, you know, superhero performances. They can rely on the defense a little more this year. So with that, Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th, Syracuse 7th, Louisville 6th, North Carolina 5th. So that leaves us with our final four. I think these next two are just on the outside looking in. They're not at that level to make it to that top two. So in fourth place, a team that I think the whole country is high on for this year. Ton of returning production. Special year last year, really, broke out collectively. And it's our friends at that school out west. I'll do Florida State in fourth place. Go Gators. So looking at their offense, a ton of returning production across the board. Offense is stacked anywhere you look. How many transfers do they bring in just everywhere? You look at this roster, it's junior transfer, senior transfer. So they're just bringing in whoever they want from wherever they want. The Keon Coleman pickup from Michigan State was huge. That's your main guy now. Johnny Wilson had a big year last year. Tough guy to defend in that secondary. Trey Benson, really broke out last year and showcased why he could be the guy. Ultimately speaking, with all that combined, while this player in particular that I'm going to pick, you would argue already had a breakout year, I'm looking at the scale and size of the breakout for this year. And I'm picking Jordan Travis. Obviously established himself as a top-tier quarterback in the conference last year. I really do think he could establish himself as a top-tier quarterback in the country if all things go well. Hopefully they don't, but... I really do think it can come together for FSU, for Jordan Travis. And the stat line speaks for itself. I just want to highlight a couple of games. 396 and 3 against Georgia Tech last year. 83 yards and 2 touchdowns against Florida. He can do it all. He can do it with his legs. He can do it through the air. He's got the receivers to do it. He's got Jaheim Bell at tight end. For Florida State, I don't have them in my top two, but that is the expectation for them. The expectation is they are going to compete and potentially win the ACC this year. I don't have them at that level right now. There's a couple of teams that I like ahead of them. I look at the games that FSU lost last year, and look at it was 3 in a row, I think, right? And every single one of them was a ranked team. You can make the argument that LSU was a ranked team. They weren't ranked at the time. That's a million-year debate. But the three that they played in a row, I think it was NC State, Pitt, and Clemson. I believe it was those three. Maybe Wake was in there as one of those three. But it was definitely Clemson. I don't remember the other two. But, they lost 3 in a row, and those were the only 3 ranked at the time. We'll use that asterisk, ranked at the time opponents that they played that year. They did beat Florida, but they struggled to do it. They did beat Oklahoma in their bowl game, but they struggled to do it. For a team that is thought to be, as dominant coming into this year, I haven't seen the dominance yet. They have the pieces to be dominant. I haven't seen that dominance last year. They embarrassed Miami. I'll give you that. I think it was 45-3, but Miami was rough last year. It was not good. So when they do it against a top tier opponent, especially this year, everyone knows that LSU is a top tier opponent in week one. If they win that game in Orlando, we'll see. It's going to decide both their seasons right off the bat. Whoever wins that game will pick the direction that their season goes in. On the defensive side of the ball, again, that front six in particular, it's the best D-line in the conference. Braden Fisk, Jared Verse obviously giving up a first-round draft grade to come back and finish the job. So some huge playmakers in the front four. In the linebacker group, Tatum, Bethune, Kalen DeLoach. So, really talented front six so far. Guys who can really, hit the quarterback, make the running back drop for a loss, put pressure on O-linemen. Like, they'll find a way to do it. The secondary is where I've got some questions. I think Renardo Green is a good cornerback. Akeem Dent is a good safety. But I look at this position group compared to the others in the conference or on their team. This is the weakness. It's going to be the DBs. I think the one that is most likely to step up is going to be Shaheem Brown. So one of only two sophomores on this defense. A little bit more limited playing time than what his teammates have had. Picked up a sack against Boston College, two passes defended against Florida. So again, as the season went on, he played a little bit more. Showed what he can do. And if Florida State doesn't want to get beat through the air, it's going to be because of a performance from Brown like bailing them out. If they've got Dent running all over the field, they got Renardo Green running all over the field, then it's going to be Shaheem Brown who's going to be one of the ones that has to step up. All right, so heading into our final three. So again, recapping: Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th, Syracuse 7th, Louisville 6th, North Carolina 5th, Florida State 4th. All right, heading back. And I think this is a team that's going to take quite a jump this year. Maybe not expected to take that big of a jump, but I think they have all the pieces in place to make a pretty big run, and it's going to be NC State. So I got NC State at 3, and it's really going to be on the back of Brendan Armstrong at quarterback. I think he's your number two guy in the conference behind Drake May. made a pretty wise decision transferring from Virginia to NC State. Really going to boost his draft stock, and as a result of that, boost NC State's chances of winning the conference. Now the pieces surrounding Armstrong are why I have some questions. I'm okay with Jordan Houston at running back. I think he's a solid guy that can get it done. But really, outside of that, who's your number one guy on offense or in the receiver room? From a production standpoint, it's probably Trent Penix at tight end. But this is not this is not going to be an offense that's going to be chucking it 8 yards every time and hope that Penix can get it on his legs. From a pure receiver point of view, you got Keon Lassane, but I think your automatic guy or your breakout player is going to be Terrell Timmons Jr., the only sophomore receiver that I think is going to start. Picked up a touchdown against UNC, and it was a good UNC team last year. 43-yard catch for the air against Virginia Tech, so he can make big plays. He can find the end zone, and as a result of having Brendan Armstrong there. And they had Devin Lear. I know he got injured, towards the end of the year. But having Brendan Armstrong, presumably for the entire year, all those guys that they're playing with, their numbers are going to boost. So expect a big year from Timmons at the receiver role. And, someone that can come back for these next couple of years and be that mainstay receiver that NC State needs. On the defensive side, I think this is where you're just going to find consistency. There's not one group that's amazing. There's not one group that's a huge liability. It's really just everyone is good enough. And I think that's going to be enough for NC State with the offense that they're going to produce this year. I like their secondary the most. Jakeen Harris at safety. Robert Kennedy at nickelback. Looking at the linebacker group, Peyton Willis is going to be your leader back there, especially in a 3-3-5. Peyton Willis is going to be someone to watch out for. But I think your breakout player is going to be on the D line, and it's not going to be Davin Van, who I think is your best returning guy, but it's going to be Savion Jackson. So this is going to be one of your DNs. Missed 7 games last year due to an injury. You know, had he not got injured, I probably wouldn't have picked him. But this is that time to bounce back in a big way. So Savion Jackson, you know, missed 7 games last year. 3 tackles against ECU. I think that would have been probably week 1 for them. So right out the gate, showing them what he could do. You know, pass defend against Charleston Southern, which, you know, again, not a lot last year. You know, Charleston Southern is not a world beater. It's an FCS school. But those little snippets of what he could do, those little moments that showcase what he could be, are going to go a long way with building this D-line up. So, again, you know, I think the receiving room is going to take a pretty large leap this year. The D-line should be better if Timmons and Jackson rise to the occasion, and you'll see the results as an NC State fan. All right, so heading into our top two, which, the only way to look at it is that's your conference championship game. So, you know, just looking at the, you know, top to bottom, or bottom to top, Georgia Tech, Virginia Tech, so 14th, 13th, Duke in 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th, Syracuse 7th, Louisville 6th, North Carolina 5th, Florida State 4th, NC State 3rd, and that leaves a conference championship game of Clemson versus Pitt. So I'll go over each team first, and then I'll tell you who I think the conference champion is. So looking at Pitt, I expect another big year from Pat Narduzzi. I expect them to step up. I think the schedule is favorable this year. Even going on the road with West Virginia, and we'll get to, you know, West Virginia on my Big 12 episode. But, I expect, you know, bigger things from the offense. Defense is going to have a lot of question marks. But I expect Pitt to be basically this year's North Carolina, where, you know, the offense is going to carry them. The defense is going to have a lot of problems. But on offense, good receiving room. Kanata Mumfield, good receiver there. Good tight end with, Gavin Bartholomew. So pieces are in place there to give, their quarterback some weapons. You know, Rodney Hammond is a serviceable running back that can keep the ball moving. But I think their breakout player is going to be their quarterback, you know, Boston College transfer Phil Yurkovic. So, you know, I believe he got injured last year. I believe he missed a few games. But, looking at what he's done with full uninterrupted playing time, 3 touchdowns against Louisville, 3 touchdowns against Rutgers, rushing touchdown against Wake Forest. So, like, the guy has shown us what he is capable of. He's shown us what he can do. If he gets the chance to do it, Pitt's going to be dangerous, especially on offense. And that's what I think is going to happen this year with Pitt on offense there with Yurkovic at QB. On the defensive side, this is where I have a lot of questions. From a returning production point of view, like, this defense is honestly probably going to be bottom of the conference. So not a whole lot that we can look at as promising points. You know, just starting up front, David Green is really your only, legitimate threat that's coming back up at defensive tackle there. Looking at the linebacker room, you got a couple of players back there. Bengali, Kamara, Shane Simon are really the only two that you've got that are, reliable in some capacity. But looking back at your secondary, that's where I think you find your breakout player. Just because there hasn't been a lot of success coming back this year. So as a result, they have to step up, and they have to be the ones to answer the call. Guys like MJ Devonshire, Marquise Williams, but I think the guy that ends up shining the most is going to be Philip O'Brien Jr. Very limited reps so far, very limited opportunities. hasn't really, shown what he can do as a, as a playmaker. Had a, three tackles in their bowl game against UCLA. Was a three-star in 2021, but if I recall, pretty high three-star. So a younger guy, a guy that could step up, a guy that could, deliver if needed. And, as a result of that, as a result of the necessity for Pitt to, to have a reliable secondary, O'Brien will be the one that steps up. So Yurkovich will be, chucking it downfield, throwing for, hundreds of yards a game. And then O'Brien will be the one shutting it down, in that secondary. And they are going to be the one that needs the biggest boost. All right, so then let's pass it over to Clemson as the final team here. So Clemson, kind of a tale of two, teams in a sense. So best running back in the conference with Will Shipley, no questions asked. The guy is gone after this year. He's going to be a day one or day two pick. Really special talent for Clemson. The receiving room has some pretty good players in there. Bo Collins is definitely someone to look at. Antonio Williams, and generally speaking, a very young offense. It's again, tale of two teams. It's a very young offense and a very old defense. So, with all they've got going on offense, strong receivers, best running back in the conference. I think it's a recipe for success for our breakout player, Cade Klubnik. So, really didn't get a ton of opportunity to play with DJ Uiagalelei as the starter last year, but really came into his own towards the end of the season. Like, it's going to be more of can he handle the pressure of the full-time starting role. Only threw two touchdowns, one against Georgia Tech, one against North Carolina. Had a rushing touchdown against Tennessee and North Carolina. Won them their conference championship game, but then laid an egg in the Orange Bowl. So it's really a matter of which Cade Klubnik are we going to see. This was, one of the top quarterbacks in his class. What would that be? Class of 2022? So showed us pieces of what he could be, showed us the growing pains that he's going to go through. And as a result of that, this will define Clemson's season. How good Klubnik is when he comes to the table. He's going to have that challenge with FSU. I think it's week four. So fortunately it's at home, but he's got that. He's got Notre Dame. He's got some good opponents to stack up against this year. And time will tell what it means for Clemson's season. On defense, Clemson defense is obviously never one to joke about. That D-line is going to be the strength of their position group in my eyes. Tyler Davis, all these grad students, obviously like next to no transfers. Dabo doesn't believe in it. But Tyler Davis up front is going to be, your real playmaker there. Linebacker group is always going to be good. I like Jeremiah Trotter and Barrett Carter, but I look at the secondary as that opportunity for a star to emerge. We've seen guys like Jalen Phillips who have stepped up in a big way. Andrew Makuba has stepped up so far during his time, but I'm going to go with one of the grad students, one of the older guys on this team. I'm going to go with Sheridan Jones. So, four-star out of 2019. So, quite a few years removed since when he was a, high schooler. His moment in the sun would have been his sixth tackle performance against Syracuse last year. So really shows what he is capable of, that he is able to stop big plays from developing and stop things, from getting worse than they are. Clemson has always kind of struggled with Syracuse for some reason, and last year was no difference. But I expect Sheridan Jones to have a more permanent role in the secondary and showcase, why he was a four-star, why Clemson wanted him, and why he's stuck around for as long as he has. So expect a big year from Klubnik at QB, Jones and quarterback. So that's what I would expect from Clemson. So looking at the conference one more time, top to bottom, and then I'll give you my champ.
Georgia Tech 14th, Virginia Tech 13th, Duke 12th, Virginia 11th, Wake Forest 10th, Boston College 9th, Miami 8th, Syracuse 7th, Louisville 6th, North Carolina 5th, Florida State 4th, NC State 3rd, and then the conference championship is Clemson versus Pitt. And in that scenario, we do not have a new champion. We're going to go with Clemson. I don't think this is going to be a surprise. Clemson has been the dominant program in the ACC for years at this point. They're going to be the champs until someone knocks them off, and I don't think it's this year. I don't think it's Pitt. I don't think it's NC State. I don't think it's Florida State. I don't think it's anyone else. It's Clemson or bust, and I'm taking Clemson. So that's all I've got for today. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for watching. Next up, we're going to have the what conference are we going to do? We're going to do Big Ten will be next. And we're going to do every conference from top to bottom. We're going to do whole Power Five. We're going to do the Group of Five, and kind of take it from there. But yeah, thank you all for watching. Hope you have a great day, and catch you in the next episode.